Hello, this is TV81974. As of 2023, still Pathfinders Detachment Leader. I want to thank you all for your support over the years. Now, I don't want to waste too much time. Today we got a really big one. I've been waiting a long time to do this video, so let's get right into it. In this brown box, I have my untrimmed, unbuilt RS Props armor kit that I've been sitting on so I could do this video. I've got tools, you know, Dremel, heat gun, everything else, E6000, our elastic straps, sticky back Velcro. Here's our little half-inch white elastic that we're gonna use to cover those shoulder bridges. We got this thin elastic here for the shoulder belt. I'm gonna get into that. Here's our 2-inch elastic that we use for the bicep and for the thigh straps on the jumpsuit. Here we've got a whole bunch of half-inch elastic, and that's that we got knee, tank. You can use this one for your shoulder as well if you want. And then we got the 1-inch for the forearm. Do I not have any 1-inch elastic? Okay, and 1-inch elastic. So as I said at the top, this is an untrimmed kit of RS Props armor, which means we get to do everybody's least favorite thing, trim the armor. Now I'm sure you all have many different ways that you go about doing this. One of the tried, true, and tested ways I have found is to use Lexan scissors. They have a little curved end so you can get those nice corners rounded out. Fortunately, our friends at RS were kind enough to put little pencil outlines where you should trim. Alrighty, so let's get our Lexan scissors and get to work. Look at this. That's how this thing is supposed to fit, right under your pectoral muscles. This is a very, very short piece of armor. It's not supposed to go all the way down here. It's like a bra. Think of it as a bra. Okay, so that's one down and about 5 billion to go. Okay, so just to make it a little bit easier on myself, I went and scored it with the Dremel. Cut it off with the Lexan scissors. Dremel's a good thing to have. Has a lot of uses and they're not expensive. Here we go. Just need some sanding. Not much to trim on the knees. It's really not too difficult to figure out what parts are to be cut. The parts that weren't up against the buck, they tend to be pretty soft. If you find that you're cutting and it's like too hard, you're probably cutting in the wrong place and you should stop doing that. A knee. And you notice knee goes like this, not like that. And the forearms, it's a beefy forearm. And folks, you know, some of you might be screaming at the camera saying, "Why did you do it like that?" I'm not a master builder. When I started out in this hobby, I knew nothing. I had no tools. I had no idea what to do. I went to the Pathfinders website and I read and I learned. A lot of you are out there just like me, don't have a lot of tools, live in a small space. I just have this tiny corner of the Endor bunker. I don't have a garage or anything like that, or a workbench. I have my, you know, table where I have my blue milk for breakfast every morning, and that's about it. But you can still do this. It's possible. I'm just knocking this stuff out. Now, another trick you can try, if you have one, is you can use a drill. And you use the drill to kind of score where you're gonna cut. take it a little bit easier on your hands. You just sort of, and then once you've done your little drilling, then you can go through and just cut along your little dots. It'll save you a little wear and tear on your fingers from the Lex and scissors. Tank, also, they were good enough to pencil in where it needs to be trimmed. And that's the tank. Folks, don't get too wrapped up with perfection. The originals were not perfect at all. I really love the RS Prop shoulder bell. That's what a shoulder bell should look like. So you keep a nice gentle curve going around. Not even ragged or anything. Very little sanding needed. My fingers hurt like hell. Ding ding. Oh, you know what I should do? Ta-da! Should have done this a long time ago. It's going through it like butter. Ba-doo! These are pretty nicely trimmed already. The drop boxes do have like a crescent cut into them so they can fit right up against your leg. They shouldn't be square at the bottom. Or at the top. Okay, so we're down to the last piece, the belt, and this thing, RS, made this thing out of some stern stuff. Gonna take some sanding to smooth out some of this. The most important thing is don't cut this off because this is where your rivet's going to go. So that's it. This is the whole kit. Everything is trimmed up. I know there's a lot of different ways to do this. I prefer the Lex and scissors just because of the control. And I really think you have less cleanup to do, especially when you get the curves perfectly. The Dremel kind of warps things a little too much. I'm not as big a fan of that. The scoring and snapping, that works pretty well too. There's not many straight edges on scout armor though. It's kind of curvy, so that's when the Lex and scissors really help. Okay, moving on with our armor build, I'd like to talk a little about sanding. Very little. With the Scout, you don't have a lot of parts that are running up against each other. Everything's kind of to itself and everything's held on with straps. You don't have to get things like perfect like you do with some other armors. There's only one area of concern, and that is the tank and the back armor. Because of the curve of the and the raised areas of the back, sometimes it's hard to get this perfectly flush. And it will involve some trimming and some sanding to get it pretty close. Keep in mind though, the originals were not very close in many instances, including with, you know, what we consider to be the Hero Scout. Also, this is connected to the back with an elastic strap, as I will show you later, so it's gonna slide. I've got mine fairly close. It's not perfect. I am gonna be attaching mine with the elastic strap, so it is gonna slide. But this is where sanding and a little, you know, careful trimming with the Lex and scissors will come in handy. Now, for sanding, there's a lot of different ways to go about doing it. My personal favorite is sanding blocks. You can get like a bag of these on Amazon for $10. They have everything from low grit to fine grit. Some of y'all like to wet sand and all this other stuff. I mean, guys, we're not painting a car here. The armor is probably not even getting painted. So, you know, you do you, but for most of you, sanding blocks will be fine. If you're feeling a little more bold, you know, you have the Dremel. The Dremel comes with a sanding attachment. Now, another option, and this is one that I'm a big fan of, because I'm super lazy and I hate sanding, is this mamma jamma right here. This one's pretty fun. It's a perfect thing to kind of go around big edges. You know, you might need to get something smaller to get the little tighter spots, but this can help you get a lot done pretty fast. You know, I know some of you with the garages and everything have your belt sanders and all that stuff, and that's great, but like I said, this tiny corner of the indoor bunker I live in, I don't have much space, so this is about as crazy as I can get with that. And that's all I have to say about sanding. I hate sanding. It's coarse, it's rough, and it gets everywhere. We've done the trimming, we've done the sanding, and now we have to get the parts ready for strapping. Some of these parts right here all require cuts so that you can feed the elastic through them. For that, we're going to use our friend the Dremel. I have the 1.5-inch plastic cutting wheel on here. If you just run it at the lowest setting you can, while still being able to cut the plastic, it'll get the job done for you. What we want to do is have very thin cuts that the elastic just barely fits through so that it doesn't pull out easily. I'm going to start with Dropbox. The molds already have indents in them where, you know, the strap is going to go. So what you want to do is get your cut like as close to the far end of that indent as you possibly can. That way the strap has enough room and this is stronger. You don't have it like right up on the edge and, you know, it can break. You know that the width of the strap going through here is 1.5 inches. This is 1.5-inch wheel, so you might have to like go back and forth a little bit to make sure there's enough room. Also, the webbing strap is thicker than elastic, so you're gonna need to do another cut, kind of like right underneath of it, just to widen it out. And I'm finding that running this at 6 works great. There we go. Got our nice little cut. I got some webbing here, test it out. Look at that. Goes right through. Okay, well, I'll do the other one. And there we have it. Okay, now with the forearm, you have a little bit smaller of a indent here. It's only for the 1-inch elastic. You just have to be careful not to let your Dremel go too far down and cut outside of the indent. Just a thin little slit. And there you go. Now the knee, very similar to forearm, has a smaller indent. So we need to be careful and make sure we don't go outside of it. There you go. And I should caution you, you should wear eye protection when you're using a Dremel because the plastic flies everywhere. I'm just hoping these glasses do the trick. Okay, now with the bicep, RS was nice enough to draw lines. This one's 2 inches, so 1.5-inch Dremel, so you're gonna have to go outside of it a little bit. Okay, so I grabbed the fabric measuring tape, which I like for, you know, curved surfaces like this. 1/2 inch from the top, 3/4 from the side. Let's make sure that line is a little more than 2 inches long. Just to be extra sure, painter's tape, this stuff is cheap. I like to use it as a guide. Okay, let's dig in. And now the holster. Basically what we need is a little cut going from this top lip here all the way down along here till it gets to this flat part here. And you want to go about 1/4 inch from the edge. And that's so that this part can insert inside of there. And there you go. Okay, and now we have the 5 cuts on this raised portion of the little holster guard here. They're just 5 little slits. They start at about the halfway point and go up about maybe 1/4 inch apart. We have a good picture of this in the Scoutopedia if you want to see how this is done. The most important thing is you just keep it like a thin cut, nothing too thick. So on here, this thing's 3.5, so I'm gonna start at 1.75.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
That ought to do it. So there you go. Just don't make them too wide. As thin as your Dremel blade. That's the thickest they should be. Don't go up and down, just side to side, that's it. Then we also have to cut the belt for the slots where the webbing goes. And it's gonna be similar to the drop box as everything else. You're just gonna go as close to that indent, to the far side of it as you can. This is for webbing, so you're probably gonna have to do a double wide. Double wide. Okay, I got my initial cuts in there. I'm just gonna put another one just below it to widen it out. There you have it. Chest and back, also 1.5 inch webbing. Keep the cut close to this side of the indent so you have lots of strength right here. And you need to do it on both sides. Let's go! There we go. Now you'll find with the chest armor that the opening is a little narrow for the 1.5 inch. This is kind of true to the film. If you look, you can see where it's kind of pinched going into the slot. And my nice baseball shirt, it's covered with plastic. All right, everybody, it's strapping time. We gotta strap this armor, and I always feel like you should start with the hardest piece first, the belt. See, there's a different array of things out here now, all the stuff that we need for the belt. Some of this stuff you might have, some of it you might need to buy, some of it you can try, you know, something else maybe. Things you definitely are going to need are your drop boxes, the belt, and your strapping. You're going to need webbing, nylon closure for the back, Velcro to attach to the nylon so you can Velcro the belt up in the back. Parachute clips, and you'll need 3mm rivets and a rivet gun. These things are not expensive. I got this for 20 bucks. The belt has to be shaped first. RS ships it like this. So you are gonna need a heat gun. If you don't have a heat gun, you can try hot water, putting it in the oven briefly, although you have to be very careful you don't warp it. ABS will warp and melt pretty easily. So yeah, I've done that before, putting pieces of armor in the oven and just pulling them out real quick and shaping them. But heat gun, you have a little bit more control over. Over here is another tool that you may or may not have laying around your house. This is a sewing machine. Don't get too scared. There's not a ton of sewing here. And the sewing that there is to do is relatively simple. So if for any reason you can't do it, you could probably get somebody to do it for you, somebody in your garrison at an armor party. Maybe you can hand sew. People that are afraid of sewing try to do everything they can to get around sewing. So they want to try to glue things, they want to try to rivet things together or use buckles. Nothing is stronger than thread. You get something sewn, it is not coming apart. I would try to get past that fear. If you can get a sewing machine, do it. I did. I don't know anything about sewing. I've had this sewing machine for almost 10 years. I still know nothing about sewing, but I've sewn a lot of my own stuff. There's some basic things that you can do that are pretty simple. All right, so let's start with the belt. And the first thing we gotta do is shape it. Now, RS Props has a great bunch of tutorials about how to build their Biker Scout. If you really wanna dive into this stuff, you should definitely check them out. Those guys know what they're doing. I don't. These videos are aimed at people like me that don't know anything. I did check out their belt tutorial to get some ideas, and they had a nice, like, $1 billion heat gun. We're gonna try this with a $20 heat gun. This one's got two settings, low and high. So, here we go. Okay, we got the first bend in. Now I'm gonna flip on the other end and heat that side. And there we have it, nice curved belt. Now remember, when you wear your belt, you're gonna wear it on your waist, not on your hips. While we're waiting for the belt to cool down, let's get our closure for the back ready. We recommend you use a 2-inch nylon strap to make the closure. Nylon's very tough, it's gonna hold up to trooping. Other fabrics will fail you. Nylon never will. Based off of my previous belt, I've determined that I'm gonna try doing 2 14-inch straps and then adjust from there. Your mileage may vary because we all have different waist sizes. I'm also not as skinny as I was when I did my last build, so I'm gonna put an extra inch or two on there. So I got this nice 36-inch strap. I only need about 28 inches of it. Okay, now one thing about nylon, and most webbing, is when you start cutting it, you get this. That's why you need flame. So just heat up the parts you cut, and that'll stop the fraying. Don't burn it, though. All right, we got our 2-inch Velcro, and we're gonna have to sew this stuff onto the nylon. I'm gonna go with 6 inches. Now this, in case you don't know, is a sewing machine. I like to use white heavy duty. I use heavy duty needles because everything that I sew is like for cosplay, so it's all heavy duty. I'm sure some of you that know what you're doing are gonna be like, what is he doing it? It works. That's why I do it. I'm gonna do something that's gonna make people go even crazier. I'm just gonna line this up by eye. I'm not even gonna put any pins. Here we go, baby. One done. Again, we're just going crazy here. No pinning. I just line up the shortest edge, make sure it's straight, and then sew it. Hope for the best. Strap number 2, done. Now, do I care if my stitches are perfectly straight? No. No one's gonna be checking your thread work. As long as this doesn't come off, that's all you care about. I want to talk briefly about one of my favorite tools. It's cheap, and it has so many uses, it's ridiculous. That's this leather punch. I bought this leather punch to punch leather, you know, but I have found that it does any kind of holes that you need in almost anything. And the reason why I bring this up is because now we got to start riveting, and I have found that it's better to put the rivet through the holes if the holes are already there. Like, don't use the rivet to make the hole. The belt is also gonna need a hole right here. And if you didn't have a drill, and I have a drill, so I'm gonna use the drill. But if you didn't have a drill and all you had was a leather punch, which is like 20 bucks, you could probably use that to put the hole. Now before you say, he's crazy, here's some of that scrap plastic from our trim, okay? That's about the same thickness as this end. Leather punch. There you go. I can see you through there. If you're down to your last dollar and you're at the hardware store and you're like, should I buy a drill or should I buy a leather punch? Buy the leather punch. You're gonna get a lot of use out of it. Okay, so like everything else, if you're gonna put holes and whatnot in your armor, you wanna make sure that you put it somewhere where it's not gonna weaken the piece. So you don't wanna put it like right here at the edge, you wanna put it back a little bit, like probably like in the center of this little tab. Okay, so the important thing is when you drill, you just make sure that the drill fits your rivet. This is a 1/8 rivet, so I'm gonna use the 1/8 bit. And likewise, on your nylon, you're going to need holes to match with these holes that the rivet's going to go through. So on the leather punch, I'm going to use the smallest setting. I'm going to put the hole in the center and about 1 inch, just so it's not too close to the end and can fray. Leather punch, it goes through. Sometimes nylon likes to snag. Light that baby up. The rule for placing Velcro is the hook should point away from your body, because you don't want that stuff scraping up against your skin. It's itchy, it hurts. Now, even though you're covered head to toe in fabric and it would never touch you, that's still common practice. Other important thing to remember is that on the scout, the rule is right over left. So you want your hook on this side, loop on that side. Now let's talk about rivets. 3 millimeter or 1/8, that's the size you want to get. Also, for the other side, you're going to want washers. So whether you use a long rivet or a medium rivet or a short rivet depends on how much material you need to go through. Here we got a bit of plastic. I'm going to try a longer rivet. See that? It's going to go through there, then through the fabric, and through that hole that I made. Other side, I'm going to put a washer. Here goes nothing. Riveting. Okay, the belt's riveted on. And remember, according to the CRL, there is one rivet on each side, and that's it. You shouldn't see any other rivets on your belt. If you were doing rivets here, 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 and all that other way like 10 years ago, we don't do it that way anymore. We do it like it was done in the movie. Another important thing to remember about rivets is you should buy aluminum rivets and not steel. Because if you make a mistake, it's a lot easier to drill out an aluminum rivet than it is a steel one. Now comes the drop box straps. So for that, I got this roll of webbing. It's kind of like a off-white, like a bone color. Now I found on my last build that I needed a strap about 4 feet long for the Dropbox straps. Don't want to start a fire down here in the bunker. Whole place might go up. Okay, so the first thing when you're threading this through, you get that about halfway in. In the back here, at the buckle, fold it in half. Make a little V shape, like that, before you send it back down. You have a little fold right there, looks like that. And then your two sides should be equal at this point. Got our parachute buckles. Gonna need 4 of these bad boys. As you know, the parachute buckles are not functional. The fabric passes behind them. So don't waste your time trying to thread them all up and cutting this into segments. It's a little hard to tell looking at screenshots, but from what I could figure out, it seems that the clip should point up towards the trooper. Okay, you following me so far? So fabric behind the buckle. Now it's feed a Dropbox through. And then on the other end, another clip. The prongs we point towards the trooper. There you go. So on your waist, closed in the back, you want the boxes up close to you, not dangling down at your hips like I see some troopers doing. The buckle should be almost touching the belt. So something like that. So once you've figured out a good position for your belt, you might want to get some safety pins and just pin it in place in the back and just try to figure out what's a good spot to attach these in the back. Now how you fix the back of the Dropbox straps is really up to you. There's different ways to do it. Some people rivet because they feel more comfortable with riveting. Some people use Velcro. I sew it so that it stays in place, and as far as I know, that's how it was done in the film. Gotta get this through the machine somehow. It's not that big of a deal. Just watch out because it's extra thick back there now. The important thing when you're sewing the webbing to the nylon is to make sure you sew each strap to a separate nylon strap. That way, you could open the belt up from the back and then close it. If you sew them to the same strap, you're in trouble. Okay, here's the belt. It's all done. So once you've done the belt, the hardest part of the costume's done. We can move on to some of the easier things. Next on the strapping list of difficulty, if the belt is here, chest, back, and tank are here. So let's tackle them next. Chest, you know, has the gray indent. Some people can paint this probably really well. I can't, so I cut this out of a vinyl decal. The measurements on it were 1 3/8 by 3/8. That's inches. I'm sorry, metric people. So we'll put the chest aside for now and move on to the tank. The tank has this greebly. They come like this from RS, so you have to paint it black. And I went ahead and drilled the hole, the 1/8 inch hole right here, so that I'll be able to put this rivet through it when the time comes. And I painted the red stripe. I have not added the white circle yet, but I will. And then the dot greebly that goes here, that'll get glued on when we attach it. The tank, as we know, has vinyl decal stripes. I'm gonna do the hero scout, so the 4 thick bars here. So to do that, we're gonna use some of this nice detailing tape. Now looking at the photos, we can see that the stripes start almost about halfway down. We'll just say 4.5, we'll call it. And that's gonna come out to about this point here. About a half inch from the main bump. That's where it will extend out to. So let's get this length. 8 inches. Peel this off, carefully lay it across, evenly. There we go. Stripe going down here, and a stripe going down here. 5 inches. And it just goes straight down. And there we have it. Okay, now for the 4 rank bars or whatever they're supposed to be. Probably supposed to be vents, I'm guessing. So this was an eighth, so this is a quarter. I'll go with an inch and a quarter. His bars seem to start just above the decals that are already there. They seem to be about a quarter inch apart. Okay, so now we have our 4 thick stripes. That just leads the trapezoid piece, which appears to be another thick stripe, but with the edges kind of cut at an angle to make it look like it's a tab or something. Cut it roughly at 45 degree angle. So you have something like this. So where's the center? Right here. And there we go. Okay, so the next thing that has to be done with the tank is the greebly needs to be attached to the top. So if you look at the picture we have of the scout from the MOTM exhibit, you'll see the greebly set back about anywhere from like about a half inch or so from the front edge. It's not right up against it. You don't want it back here, but you don't want it here. You want it about there. So this piece is going to get glued on with our good friend E6000, but it's also going to have a rivet put through it. There's a little bit more to the rivet than just attaching this greebly to the tank, so we're just going to glue it for now. We'll do the rivet in a little bit. Okay, so I'm just going to scuff up these surfaces a little bit to give the glue something to bite into. E6000. It's a great adhesive. It really stinks. It's not good to use indoors. As soon as I put this glue on here, this thing's gonna go outside into the forest to dry. It smells so bad, I'm gonna hold my breath while I'm doing this. Okay, make sure your dial's like right along the center. And then we're gonna put a clip on it. And then, like I said, this bad boy's going outside to dry. Back in a second. Whew, that was stinky. I'm glad to have that out of here. Okay, so while we're waiting for that to set, there's still some other things we can do with the tank, back, front, all that other fun stuff. Namely, getting the back piece connected to the front piece. So when these go together on you, these two points here should be bumping up against each other so that they can be covered with the strip. For folks that have problems fitting the scout armor because it's a little tight right here, just know that you can always add more strap to the sides. What you don't want to see is adding like long covers here to stretch this out. But just remember, you can add as much side strap as you need to make it fit. So I'm going to line these up, and I'm just going to put some tape to affix them together while I test out this fit. From my experience wearing different scout armors over the years, this feels pretty good, this amount of shoulder strap. I don't think I need to remove any. You might have to remove some if you're on the smaller side and it's hanging down too low in the front or the back, but this seems to be the right fit for me. Okay, so the question then becomes, how do we connect these two pieces together? Now obviously there's going to be straps running from here to here, but that's not what's going to be doing all the heavy lifting. So what I use to hold these pieces together is industrial sticky back Velcro. We'll put the loop up here at the top, and then the hook at the bottom. Stuff is hard to get apart. Yeah, probably have to cut it in half. Yeah, 4 inches. Then we're gonna cut these in half. So our pieces are connected at the top with the sticky back Velcro. Why sticky back Velcro, you ask? Well, you'll find out soon enough. So now that we've got them joined up, we don't want to see these ugly joins, do we? No. So we're going to cover them up with the shoulder bridges. Now I have looked at those shoulder bridges very carefully. I believe that what they are is just a strip of elastic glued over the top. I don't even think it goes all the way around. I'm just going to take a strip of this and just glue it down with good old super glue. You want enough to wrap around the sides, but they don't necessarily have to go all the way around in a loop. I mean, you don't necessarily want a loop going around here because you might want this area freed up. So now we gotta do the strap that goes around here. In my last build, I made like a little belt out of Velcro in the front so I can make it tight. But I do like the little stitch going down the side that you can see in the screenshot, so I want to do both. So what I'm going to do is make a belt that connects in the back with the clip. Makes sense? Let's do it. So I started out with like a 40-inch piece of webbing, cut this in half. Probably if I had thought this out better, I would have done this in a different order, but oh well. Let's feed in here. Go to about there, maybe. Nothing worth doing is ever easy. Like I said, if I had thought of this earlier, I would have put the strap on before I put this together. But you're learning from my mistakes. And we've got one of our 1.5-inch clips. Nobody likes to see how the sausage gets made. So I've got stitches here, like in the pictures. I made this adjustable belt. Put it on like this, pull it tight when I get it on, and then clip it in the back. All right, our chest is really coming along. We just have to put the tank on the back. Now, like I said earlier, I'm going to affix the tank with the black elastic strap. Black elastic strap is held onto the tank by the rivets that are on the top and then in the bottom center. I prefer having the elastic strap over just affixing it permanently because that way I can take the tank off when I need to. So we get to do more sewing, your favorite. We're gonna get some 1/2-inch elastic and this little teeny tiny baby 1/2-inch parachute buckle. We're gonna make a tank strap that is held together with the parachute buckle so that it can be taken on and off easily. We'll do 2 12-inch segments. If they are too long, you can always make them shorter. If they're too short, you can't make them longer. So this side's gotta get sewn down permanently. This one is the adjustable side. I'm not gonna sew it at this point. I'm gonna wait till we put our tank on and see how much play we have. Okay, here's our tank with our greebly glued on. We need to drill a hole through the greebly hole into the tank where the rivet's gonna come out. This one you're gonna need a long rivet for. Going through 2 pieces of plastic. And I think we all know the weird thing about the rivet on the greebly is that it was done from this side. So the washer and the broken end is on this side. I've looked at a bunch of different pictures of different scouts and all the greeblies seem to have been done that way. So we'll take our adjustable side one. This is where the rivet's gonna go through. We need to put a hole in this. So what are we gonna use? Let me hear it in the back. Leather punch. And you thought this was just for punching holes in leather. Okay, now let's make our little rivet sandwich. So rivet goes through the elastic, up into the tank, the washer on top. Rivet it on with the strap. Now at the bottom, the rivet's kind of like right about here. Let's get the photo and take a look. And if you look, you can even see the elastic strap pushed off to the side. So I'm gonna mark a little spot. Yep, that looks right. Probably use a short rivet for this one. Then we're gonna get our other strap, leather punch. So we're gonna have rivet going through the tank, through the other elastic strap with the washer on top. Can you see that? Have our elastic strap. Elastic with a parachute connector. I ended up going 8 inches and 8 inches on the top and bottom strap. 12 and 12 is way too long. So there we have it. Chest, back, and tank. Dunzo. Okay, now that we have the chest put together and assembled, let's add the next piece to it, which is the shoulder bells. Now we learned by careful examination and some insider info that the shoulder bells were held in place to the chest armor by zip ties. You can see in some screenshots the zip ties pretty clearly once you start looking for them. So we're gonna set that up right now with this one. So you'll need some long zip ties. I got 11-inch zip ties here. And you'll need zip tie anchors. Now zip tie anchors are really strong. My last shoulder bells I've had on there for 6 years, and the zip tie anchors that hold the zip tie to the bell have not given out. Because we could see in one photo particularly that there's a loop, zip ties loop like that, I made like a rail with one 11-inch zip tie, folded it in half, and put zip tie anchors with the sticky sides pointing up at each end of the top. like this. But if you want to recreate what I just did, you can take an 11-inch zip tie, fold it in half, and put one zip tie anchor here to the fold, other zip tie anchor here at the top, and then just push the top through the other side until it clicks like once or twice. Not all the way, not too far. So something like that. And if the zip tie anchor slide up and down along this rail, it's fine. You kind of want that movement in your shoulder bell. Now that you have your little rail made, we can make the connection between the shoulder bridge and the shoulder bell. With the shoulder bell, this took a little bit of experimentation, but to get the distance right between the bell and the shoulder joint, and you can see in screenshots, it's very close. They're only about like an inch apart. I found that if I measured out a spot about 2 inches from the top, that was a good place to put the anchor. So using my fabric tape, because we have another curved surface here, go 1, 2 in the center, draw a little line, and then on the side with the where it connected, peel that off, place it right here. And remember, the zip tie anchors are super strong. They need force to come off, and they will stay on a very long time. The anchors I'm using with my costume now have been there for 6 years and have shown no sign of falling off. With this anchor, remember the sticky back Velcro we put up here at the loop? And I said we'd get back to that? This is when we get back to that. Cut a square piece of hook, and this is industrial Velcro, just like the loop, so it's gonna hold about 15 pounds. Peel off the back of the zip tie anchor, peel the back of the Velcro off, stick it on right here. So now we have an industrial Velcro attachment that can attach to our armor and become detachable. And this can stay like this. Now let's try it on. Got our shoulder bells attached to our chest, but they're not secured by anything. So the next thing we gotta do is put on the armbands for these. There's a bit of a question mark about the shoulder bell armbands. Back in the day, we used to use like a thick piece of elastic along the bottom, which was more of like a stormtrooper type of attachment, but there's no photographic evidence really to back that up. I've looked at screenshots and I've yet to see one that definitively shows what kind of attachment was used to hold them to the arm. So what I suspect was a thin piece of elastic, a quarter inch, half inch, maybe even elastic cord attached by a zip tie anchor inside the bell going through the armpit, holding it down kind of at a diagonal angle rather than across the bottom. That seems more logical and it seems like it fits better with the photo evidence, so that's how we're gonna do these. I bet you thought we were done with the sewing machine. Wrong. So I've got some quarter inch elastic here. Could use half inch. You could probably use elastic cord too. And I just measured this circumference through my armpit. I did it a couple times and I got 20 inches. Now, taking into account I'm gonna be wearing a flight suit and a vest, 20 inches is probably gonna stretch somewhat, which is what we want. We want the elastic to kind of be pulling. We don't want it to be loose. You, of course, measure yourself, see what works best for you. I'm gonna take this and sew it into a loop. So now you should have 2 loops, 2 shoulder bells, 2 zip ties, 2 zip tie anchors. We're gonna take a loop, we're gonna take a zip tie anchor, we're gonna take a zip tie. We're going to attach the loop to the anchor with the zip tie. It's pulled as tight as it'll go. And then snip off the end. So you should have a loop attached to an anchor. You want to have it so that the loop is going through your armpit. So a place to have the anchor attached inside the bell wouldn't be down here. You want it more in the center. So a good place to put it would be underneath the zip tie anchor that's already there for the shoulder attachment. So like right there. That way when you put it on, it's pulling this part of the bell towards your arm, not the bottom part. Pull the bottom part towards your arm, you're gonna have your vest flaring out, and you don't want that. So when you're finished, you should have something like this. These get attached to the chest. A good spot is right here where it flattens out, close to the shoulder joint, which is why I said a loop is not always the best idea, because you might want this area freed up to attach this. So you've got something like this, just pop it over your head. So in conclusion, now we have both shoulder bells attached to the chest armor with zip ties and secured with elastic straps that pass through the armpit. Perfect thing for being able to do stunts, punch Han Solo. Boom. Moving on to the third most difficult piece of the armor, we have the holster. The big difficulty with the holster is it's in two separate pieces, so you have to kind of cut them and shape them to make sure they fit into each other nicely. You have to attach the holster guard to the main shaft of the holster. So to do that, there's a couple things you can do. One, it's important for you to take your blaster and make sure it fits. I have this Darth Voorhees rubber blaster. So if I put it in here and see, you know, where it goes, it's just barely in there. Heating and bending this piece and gluing it on probably wouldn't be a good option for me. So what I do is I get a piece of scrap ABS that I have from other builds, you know, just laying around, and I will glue that in there to secure these two pieces together. If you don't have any scrap ABS, there's different ways you can get it. You can go to the hardware store and get like a for rent sign, you know, a sturdy one, not one of the paper ones. I've heard people use old credit cards before. So I'm gonna take my piece of scrap ABS, I'm gonna heat it with the heat gun to just mold it right so it fits in there. Then I'm gonna glue it to everything with the E6000, and that'll get the holster ready for attaching to the boot. So as you see, we've clamped in the little bracket I made, and we're gluing everything together. Our holster is dried. Pop the gun in it, it's gonna stay. So now it's time to attach this to our boot. For my boot, I got my hands on some original Sierra sneakers from the 80s, and I used the Crow Props leather upper. The holster goes here, centered on the outside of the boot, so it's looking straight down on your side, a half inch to a quarter inch below the top. It's pretty close up there while not being right on the edge. The back of it comes fairly close to this seam in the back. There are screenshots showing how it's on there. It looks like in a lot of cases they were rushed on because some of the holsters are a little crooked. On the holster, we're going to use our 1/8 bit for our 1/8 or 3mm rivet. We're going to drill little holes here, 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 and here. I already marked them. Okay, we've got our four holes. Now we just got to mark out on the boot where we're going to put holes here, so we can push the rivet through it. So we've got our four holes marked on our boot. We need something that can put holes through leather. I wonder what it can be. Oh, putting holes in leather. Ah. Rivet goes in this way, through the plastic, through the hole on the other side, and then we're gonna put washer on the other end. All right, now we just gotta do this four more times and we're done. Our holster is affixed. Fun fact, the holsters originally were supposed to be strapped on. You can see this in the early promotional photos that the production sent out to Kenner to make the toys from, and that's why to this day, if you look at a Biker Scout toy, it has the strapped holster and not the riveted one. Noisy cricket. We are really getting down to the end here. Okay, thermal detonator. The Greeblies. I put mine on in the traditional way that we had written up in the CRL with the prongs up on the badge and the circle here going left to right. I know we did something controversial a few years back when we changed this. This configuration was based off of one scout that you could clearly see. He was the blue screen scout during the speeder bike chase. With clearer imagery and being able to look at more scouts throughout the movie, you find that this doesn't always hold up as the way to do it. You see him like this, you see him with the badge going each and every way. So what Command did was we took some time, we laid out every screenshot we could find, and we examined them all to try to figure out what the rule was. And the rule is actually pretty simple. The housing has a long side and a short side. The badge goes on the long side, and the dot goes on the short side. And that's it, that's the only rule. Now whether the housing is turned this way or this way, that's up to the trooper. Whether the badge goes prongs up or prongs down, that's also up to the trooper. The only thing that holds in every instance is badge on the long side, dot on the short side. That's all you gotta do. I still like this way the best. I just think it looks neat, so this is what I'm going with. I've already drilled out the holes for the zip tie that's gonna connect this to the tubing. Now the tubing. In the film, of course, they used a tube wrapped in wire. That's how I did my detonator on my Strider kit. I took a extension cord and pulled it apart, wrapped it, then I spray painted it like a gray beige. You'll find that if you spray paint an electrical cord, it gets very tacky. The material of the electric cord starts having reaction to the paint and it gets all sticky and gross. That's not a problem. All you have to do is clear coat the tube when you're done, after the paint dries. It's fine, not tacky at all, and it's been this way for years. Now, some folks find the wire-wrapped thermal detonators to be a little heavy. Mine's not too heavy. This whole thing only weighs 13 ounces, so less than a pound. But RS came up with a nice solution. They wire-wrapped one and then molded it and made it into like a fake wire-wrap thermal detonator. So it's a little bit lighter. All the components together weigh about 9 ounces, so 4 ounces less than my wire-wrapped one. What you're gonna need to put this all together, you need the tubing with the end caps glued on. You're gonna need the housing with the badges inserted and holes drilled for the zip tie. You're gonna need a zip tie. You should probably get a long one so you have plenty of room to play around. Clips. These drill clips have been favorites around the detachment for years and years. We have links to these on the site. They have the holes already in them. Some people like to cut out this part to make it look even more like the screen used. If you can do it, go ahead. I don't have the capability to do it. But I find that once you put it on, you can't really see the backing anyway, so it's not really that big of a deal. And then this material, it's kind of like a stick almost. So I got some wood screws and I'm gonna use that to affix the clips. Okay, I'm gonna have my badge facing this way. So let's put the zip tie on first. You have to go in through back and then bring it back over the top like that so that we have the line showing. Now on this side, we can rest our thermal detonator tube. You want it so that it's kind of like going up on the sides like a smile. Close up the zip tie, snip off the excess. Before we affix the clip, it might help just to kind of stretch it out a little bit because it's very tight, and if it's too tight, you're gonna have a hard time getting it over your belt. Just kind of loosen it up a bit so it's more like that. Now we'll affix these to the tube. And there you have it. This is ready to be slid on the back of your belt. Also, if you wanna make sure that the screw stays in there really tightly, you can always drill in and insert a wall anchor like you would for drywall, glue that in, and then you can drill in your screw into that. I might, in the future, just continue to use my Strider thermal detonator with the wire wrap tube. It is a little more screen accurate, and I am kind of an accuracy nut, but it is nice to have the option of a lighter one. All right, we are down to the last few pieces here. We just need to strap up the bicep, the forearm, and the knee. Very easy, that's why I saved this for last. I've already done half of it already, so let's finish this up. So for strapping these remaining pieces, you're just gonna need a few things. You're gonna need the correct elastic strap sizes. We have 2 inch, 1/2 inch, 1 inch. For the knee, you're gonna need rivets and washers, the rivet gun, and leather punch. And finally, to hold it all into place, and this may surprise some of you, but what we need is hot glue gun. We gotta get this thing hot, and I'm talking hotter than Mustafar. The glue works best when it's as hot as it can be. Okay, we'll start with the bicep first, because that's the easiest. Now remember, we got our thin slits. There's a reason why I asked you to cut them thin, and that's so they can bite onto the elastic and the elastic won't tear out so easily. So what we're gonna do first is we're gonna thread in one side. Then we'll extend it all the way across this flat portion of the bell here before it gets to the indent. We're gonna take our hot glue and smear it liberally inside and then smush down the elastic. It's hot. So now that we got the one side down, we're gonna take our elastic, like around the back, like it would extend. We wanna make sure it's straight. and not bowed. You want to get this pretty tight. So take it around to here, across the front, just so you can get an idea of how long the piece needs to be. Probably need to cut it about here. Grab scissors, cut, thread this second side. Make sure this is going straight across. It's not bowing at all. Then pull it just a little tight, not too tight. Don't put a lot of pressure on the plastic, but just a little tight. Now we've got the other side in, we're just gonna hot glue this end down. And there you have it. It's strapped up. Now I know it seems ridiculous using hot glue. I did this on my last armor. I put the hot glue down in 2017. It is now 2023 and it is still holding fine. It works. And the good thing about hot glue is if you make mistakes, they're easy to correct. Forearm, principle is gonna be the same as with the bicep, except we're using 1 inch instead of 2 inch. So feed it in on one side, extend it all the way down to the flat part, and then hot glue it in, like so. Then go across the back here, keep it kind of straight, extend it down the front, about where you think it'll go on the inside, and then cut it, then feed it in through the other side, and repeat the gluing. Forearm is done. And finally, the knee. And the knee goes like this. Not like this. This is ridiculous. If you're sitting down, the cup is digging into your shin. This should rest on top of your knee. Anyway, half inch. Feed in on the first side, and then we'll glue down. Glue, lay the elastic across, go across the back, pull it so it's flat, extend along the front just to get an idea how far you want to cut. Cut, feed it in, pull it just a little tight, but not too tight. You don't want to put a lot of pressure on the plastic, you don't want it to crack. Glue, lay down the elastic into the glue. Okay, once the glue is cooled down, we can add the upper strap, which a lot of people have nicknamed the Lancer strap. At one time, it was a level 2 requirement, the strap. We have since changed it to be optional because looking at the movie stills, we see that there's actually more scouts without the strap than actually have it. We need to put a hole on both sides just below this indent here. So just about here. I'm not even gonna use a drill. I'm gonna use this. Perfect. No drill needed. We need our 1/8 or 3 millimeter rivets. Short ones will work in this case. And we'll need 2 washers and then some more half inch elastic. Use the leather punch to make the hole in the elastic. Now this elastic goes across the inside. It doesn't start out here on the outside like these other pieces do. So first thing you do is you feed your rivet in like so on this side. In the back, push in the elastic. And then finally, the washer. Take our handy rivet gun. There we go, that's one side. Now with the upper knee strap, you don't wanna pull it tight like you do with the lower one. You wanna give it a little bit of slack because it pulls hard against your leg, so you don't want it to be cutting off circulation. Just give it a little bit of slack, not too much. And there you have it. You have your upper knee strap. Okay, now we're finished with the armor. We have trimmed, we have strapped, we have assembled. So the next step in our Scout Trooper build is to make the soft goods. Now I know soft goods are usually...
Trooper, what's going on here?
Oh, I'm just teaching the new recruits.
No, no, you do not have security clearance to access this room or this information. Please shut this down immediately.